CNN had a panel of experts that are going to discuss Donald Trump's speech. And there's one, I guess only one Trump supporter there, and I'm a little shaky on him, but I'm going to try to keep my comments brief if possible.
Swing state of Ohio. I have a panel of experts and reporters standing by, so let's just get right to it. And General Wesley Clark, let me just bring you in first. I know you're a supporter of Hillary Clinton's, and just to look at how he opened this speech, you know, ticking off all the different cities, both here and abroad, terror attacks, ISIS-directed attacks, ISIS-inspired attacks, and the fact that he said we cannot let this evil continue. He said the rise of ISIS is a direct result of decisions by Obama and Hillary Clinton. Now, you can argue that, but can you argue, when you look at all of these attacks, that it has gotten better under this current administration, General?
I think you have to argue that this is a problem that has to be worked, and that's exactly what the administration is doing, and that's what Hillary will do. But I think you do have to argue with the fact that it was caused by Barack Obama. All of the problems he cites with Iraq began, including the Nation Bill, it began with George Bush. And the idea that we would leave U.S. troops there to guard oil wells and oil refineries and pipelines and take their oil is, it's crazy. MacArthur did not do that. General MacArthur didn't do that. General Patton wouldn't have done that. So all that part of the speech shows that Mr. Trump doesn't really understand. Now, we have a problem with ISIS, and we have to work it. But it's not the only national security problem we have. We have a problem with Russia. We have a problem in the South China Sea. We have many problems that we're working simultaneously. And I guess the thing that struck me most about Mr. Trump's speech was that he was so simplistically focused on ISIS. Just take this example. He's
Why is that being simple?
Killings,
Why is that being simplistic?
Because when you say that you're going to be an ally with anybody that fights ISIS, there are many people fighting ISIS that may have conflicting interests with you in other parts of the world. And you have to have a sophisticated enough understanding of foreign policy to be able to handle all this.
Yes, yeah, specifically, isn't Syria fighting ISIS? And I guess Russia's fighting ISIS. So I guess we're supposed to be allies with Russia and Syria. Really? Donald Trump not thinking it all out all the way.
I know that Hillary Clinton can handle that. She can fight against ISIS. She can deal with Putin effectively in Eastern Europe. She can work effectively with China and with China's neighbors in the South China Sea. I don't know that Mr. Trump can do that from this speech on national security. What I see is a single-minded focus on one problem, and I don't see a solution to it. Everything he cited that he would do is being done right now by this administration in terms of cyber, working with allies, and all that in the Middle East.
Okay, General, thank you. Let me come back to you in a second. Let me just go to our Trump supporter, John Hajar. And so, John, just quickly, a specific question on when we just heard Mr. Trump reference, you know, when it comes to terror suspects, either abroad or here at home, that he would handle them with extreme and vicious measures.
Yeah.
What did he mean specifically by that?
All right, let me real quick. This guy never answers the question as to exactly what is extreme. He basically is going to say that we need to enforce our laws. And in my mind, that's not extreme. That should be the normal course of business. And also, the group that this guy belongs to, the American Mideast Coalition for Trump, I tried to find some information on this particular group, and there really isn't any. I mean, they make a statement that they have members from a tremendous number of countries throughout the Mideast, but as far as any specific information on the group itself, there really isn't anything out there. And on their website, they basically are backing Trump pretty much on any position that he takes. So that's just a little information for you to have before you start listening to this guy.
I think we're going to enforce the laws that are on the book, but just I'd like to make a quick comment in response to General Clark.
Could you actually first answer my question? With all due respect, could you answer my question? Then I promise we'll give you time to do that.
Absolutely. The specific response to your question is, we will enforce laws that are on the book that are not being enforced now. When someone commits a crime and they're not eligible, I mean, I'm not an immigration law expert, but I'm sure there are provisions of the law that are not being focused on by this administration, that are being ignored by this administration, that will call for somebody losing their resident status. You don't automatically get your citizenship. It's a process, and we will vet these individuals, making sure that they pledge allegiance to this country. As Mr. Trump said, the U.S. Constitution will take precedence over Sharia law under a Trump administration.
Understood, and I think he was referencing the extreme vetting.
All right, now, as I indicated, he didn't answer a question as to exactly what is extreme, okay? And then when you become a citizen of the United States, you have to renounce all citizenship and alliances to any other country when you become a citizen. So what he's saying, basically, is that's already being done. And as far as Sharia law is concerned, Sharia law is, you know, it's a bunch of crap. Sharia law is a construct. It's not Islamic law. It's a construct of some Islamic laws together with some laws, if you want to call them, of Western Europe that were put together so that when they left the region, those particular, you want to call them, doctrines were in place. And Sharia law differs from basically country to country.
But if I may, what he was saying, terror suspects, he had referenced in the past, fighting fire with fire, talking waterboarding, and that's where I was going. So you don't believe when he said vicious measures that he was referencing that the U.S. should waterboard?
Well, I think the president will follow our Constitution. It's not being followed now. Whatever the law allows justice, and I think that a Trump presidency will make sure that justice is done for people that seek to do us harm.
All right, so right off the bat, this guy is making an interpretation on Trump. And Trump clearly said early on, which I guess he backed away from, is that he would actually want to perform waterboarding or even tougher enhanced interrogation methods against terrorists. And that is against not only our law, but the Geneva Conference. So, I'm sorry, the Geneva Convention. So, I don't know what this guy's talking about.
That will bring us together, not divide us. And my response to the general is, he has not engaged whatsoever the moderates in the Muslim community. Our organization, American Mideast Coalition for Trump, is the largest ever assembled Mideast group. We have Kurds, we have Turks, we have Arabs, we have Assyro-Chaldeans, we have Egyptians, we have Copts. Christian, every kind of Muslim, every kind of Christian. And universally, we've seen the failure of this administration, which would be furthered by a Hillary Clinton administration, where the radicals have been engaged, like the Muslim Brotherhood and the Iranian regime, which is the largest state sponsor of terrorism, completely to the detriment of the people on the ground in the Middle East. They have suffered tremendously. We talk, as an American, of course, we're so concerned with the suffering of Americans at the hands of terror in Western Europeans, but nobody's taking it on the chin. Nobody's putting their necks literally on the line more than the people in the Middle East, especially the ethnic and religious minorities there. And we've
that's bullshit. There's nobody that's got their neck on the line in the Middle East more than the Muslims that ISIS is basically killing if they don't toe the ISIS line. So that statement in itself is not correct. Yes, ISIS is going after minority religions throughout the areas that they are in control of, i.e. Syria, Iraq, somewhat in Afghanistan. But the number of people killed by ISIS is Muslim by a wide, wide margin.
Done nothing whatsoever in 7 years. Believe me, I've been knocking on the doors, and they've been slammed in my face for 7 years from this administration that only wants to talk to the likes of Council of American Islamic Relations and other Muslim Brotherhood-affiliated organizations on the Sunni side and on the Shiite side. They've bent over backwards to make the deal with the Iranian regime, the evil Iranian regime.
General Clark, would you like to respond to that?
Certainly. I mean, I know for a fact that the Obama administration's done outreach after outreach to the Muslim American community. I can't speak for the specifics of the organization John's with. There are dozens and dozens of Muslim American organizations. I've talked to many of them myself personally, and they're working very hard. They're working closely with the Obama administration. They're also giving a lot of guidance to the Obama administration. They're mostly concerned about the welfare of their own people and how people are going to be treating them and making sure that their Muslim American community doesn't support ISIS. So I've found these groups to be extremely patriotic, found them to be good Americans. That's who they are. That's why they came here, and that's why they stay here. So I think the charge that the Obama administration is not doing enough with the Muslim American community is just absolutely wrong, and I can promise you from everything I know about Hillary Clinton and the people around Hillary Clinton, she will do everything she can with the Muslim American community.
Let me go to London.
I can give you specifics if you like, General. That's just not the case.
Just a minute, gentlemen, to both of you. Clarissa, let me just pivot to you. Clarissa Ward is our senior international correspondent. She's been to all these countries that we've heard referenced both from Mr. Trump and also from Hillary Clinton. First, just your initial thoughts on the speech.
My initial thoughts with a lot of it, as General Clark just said, seem to be stating the obvious or stating things that the U.S. is already doing. Cut off funding, develop allies. Stop recruitment. Well, yes, stopping recruitment is a great idea. How do we do it? You heard Trump proposing that we cut off the internet in those areas. I'm not sure how exactly that would work, but I'm pretty sure it would limit the abilities of our intelligence services to collect valuable intel on these men who are fighting with ISIS, because of course the internet is how so much surveillance is being done by our security services. He talked about fostering better relations with allies that embrace his notion of moderate Islam. He cited President Sisi of Egypt and the King of Jordan. But of course, Egypt and Jordan already have very close ties to the U.S., and indeed the U.S. spends a lot of funding on helping both of those countries. He seemed to have a much more bombastic stance when it came to countries like Iran and to Saudi Arabia, but it remains unclear how one would navigate the waters of essentially being the leader of the free world as the U.S., while having no strong relationship with those two countries, which of course are the two main countries in the region. He also talked about Syria and Libya, and he singled them out as these are both examples of absolute disasters of the Obama presidency. But of course, in the case of Libya, we saw an active U.S. intervention and with certainly disastrous consequences, though there have been some major gains on the ground against ISIS by U.S.-backed forces last week. But in Syria, there has been very little action from the U.S. and no intervention. So it doesn't seem a fair way to compare them directly when they're both different and contradicting policies. So all in all, Brooke, I would say there were a lot of suggestions that seem to contradict each other, and quite a few that, quite frankly, are already being done on the ground.
I do want to follow up with you, or perhaps Ben Wiedemann, in a moment, just about how he painted, you know, back in 2009, Libya, Iraq, and Syria as more stable and less violent, and how he had said ISIS, quoting him, was close to being extinguished, or what the group we now know to be ISIS. But Gail, let me just pivot to you quickly on how he talks about, you know, U.S. allies, and how he mentioned anyone willing to help. You know, if you fight terror, thus you become an ally of the United States. And my question to you is he redefining what it means to be an ally of the U.S.?
Yeah, I mean, I think this whole speech was a series of disparate pieces that don't necessarily fit into the same puzzle. And that is what is so interesting, because in places like Syria, you do see Americans really working with allies who don't necessarily share broader American values. And to Clarissa's point about nation, you know, what we're seeing from this speech, you know, nation building is something that Trump said, you know, this is the end of it. But if you go back to Obama's speeches, as early as May 2011, June 2012, he was saying, you know, it's time to focus on nation building here at home. And when you talk to senior military folks, they say that's actually part of the problem, was that there's a vacuum, the vacuum Trump talks about, that was created in part because nation building, which is a 14-letter word, has become this four-letter word in the minds of many people looking at U.S. foreign policy. And the vacuum that that's creating, which is creating the need even more for allies who don't necessarily share American values, are really leading, in many people's views, to vacuums on the ground that then make a fertile territory for groups like ISIS. So I do think that there are disparate pieces here that do not necessarily converge.
So that was one piece he talked about, how, you know, talking about U.S. allies under a Trump presidency. And two, Phil Mudd, he talked about, you know, people who'd want to come into the United States, you know, referenced the Cold War and ideological screening then, and called what he would call extreme vetting. So if you try to come into the United States, there would be some sort of test for entry if you are, you know, anti-Semitic, anti-gay, or other views that would conflict with U.S. values. A, would it be enforceable? B, would that be constitutional? Phil?
I don't know if it'd be constitutional. I can tell you I don't think it would be enforceable with one major asterisk, and let's get to that because he didn't address it. When you have a screening process on the front end, let's take the San Bernardino killers. Yeah. How confident are we that they're not going to walk in saying, you know, I'm a loyal American, I want to be a loyal American? The question to me is simpler. Once they get here and they do something wrong, we've typically been very welcoming to people once they arrive. What he's suggesting is a fundamental choice for American voters. Do you want to be quicker to tell somebody who has some of the rights of the Americans that we're going to expel them if we see, for example, ISIS sympathetic literature on a Facebook post? If a neighbor says, I heard him say something about ISIS. It's not screening on the front end, it's what you do on the back end.
So these are the policies. Let me just pivot and talk politics. David Chalian, our CNN director, I jotted down this note that jumped out at me when he said Hillary Clinton lacks, quote, the mental and physical stamina to take on ISIS. Mental and physical stamina. You know, listen, I don't have Donald Trump here to explain precisely what he means, but what might he be referring to?
Well, this is actually an argument he's been making about Hillary Clinton for months and months. You remember that he successfully labeled Jeb Bush as low energy, and that had sticking power to it in the primary season. He was also putting out this kind of language about Hillary Clinton for the last many months, too. Again, a message of his strength versus her weakness in the way he frames this. But Brooke, I do think, just looking back at this politically for a moment,
sure.
Donald Trump is on firmer ground today, having debating among all your guests his specific proposals or vision is a place that is a stronger political place for him than a campaign that is in crisis and concerned that they can't keep him on message. So to me, politically, the argument that he made today, I actually think he made very early in the speech. I think it was when he went through Libya and Syria and Iraq and Egypt, and he pointed to the way all those places looked in January 2009 before the Obama-Clinton administration came into place, and then how they look now. And that, whether or not he and Hillary Clinton obviously can debate and disagree about the proposals to make those places better, that could be a very compelling political argument for him if he's able to sustain it and stay on it, that the world may appear a little more chaotic to American voters here at home now, that region of the world, than it did when Barack Obama first took office.
David, thank you. Just back to General Clark, to you and this notion of nation building, the idea of getting away from nation building, it's a popular one, would it not be, in America now in 2016?
It is popular to get away from nation building. However, the truth is that it was George W. Bush who said we weren't going to do nation building. Then we went into Afghanistan, and it turned out that we had to. We're doing a lot of nation building around the world, and we have for a long time. We do it by our culture, by the economy, by tourism, by trade, by many other things. In Eastern Europe today, where Vladimir Putin is reaching out to try to subvert governments, we're doing nation building. We're doing it with diplomacy. We're not doing it with forces over there. So nation building goes on all around the world because people like our values and they aspire to those values. So really the idea that you just cut off nation building, build a wall, it's just not realistic. That's why I say his speech is extremely simplistic. It is incoherent in its pieces, and it was ultimately the best job they could do to keep Donald Trump from being Donald Trump failed when he said, we'll invade a country and take their oil. I know it's a big applause line in some audiences, but it absolutely doesn't make sense, and no military leader would support occupying a country and trying to guard its oil reservoirs and all of its infrastructure to repay debts. We don't do that in the 21st century. We didn't even do it in the 20th century. After we invaded Germany, we helped rebuild the German economy for Germany. And we made Germany, it shows that we have someone here who, he's not ready to be president. He's read a speech off a teleprompter, but the real Donald Trump is still showing through here.
Not ready to be president, incoherent, simplistic. John, is that fair?
Absolutely not. I think it was his best speech on foreign policy. I think you can clearly see from the past 7 years, there's been a failure of foreign policy of this administration, which will be carried on by a Clinton presidency. Clearly, the people know it. The press can tell us whatever we want, but the people can see the frequency and the extremity of these Islamic terrorist attacks are increasing. And by the way, Donald Trump was clear that was not in favor of the initial invasion of Iraq. He didn't want to walk away from our allies. He wanted to stay with our allies in Iraq, unlike Barack Obama, who abandoned them. And that's what I'm hearing from our people on the ground here and from their relatives, friends, associates in the Middle East, that the United States under President Barack Obama abandoned our allies. That's the antithesis of what a Trump administration would be. We'll stand by our allies, Israel, King Abdullah in Jordan, President al-Sisi, who was ignored by this administration. We will stand by them. We'll create safe zones so the real refugees from the Middle East won't have to trek thousands of miles and risk their lives in rickety boats to drown in the Mediterranean.
Now, that one is the one that really kind of gets me. So what he's saying is we're going to go into Iraq or even Syria and build safe zones. Then, in order to protect those safe zones, you got to put boots on the ground, basically, and a lot of military in order to protect those quote-unquote safe zones. How the hell do you do that? Okay, without... Sorry about that. How do you do that without taking casualties? Because you know damn well that the ISIS people are going to be taking pot shots at every opportunity to try to kill the American or coalition soldiers that would be guarding those safe zones. So that in itself is not going to make a whole hell of a lot of sense. I mean, you probably would have to create safe zones and then clear out about at least 20 miles to prevent any casualties being taken just on the guard duty itself. I mean, if anybody's got any ideas or can explain it to me, more than happy to listen to it.
We'd be able to stay in their homeland in protected areas and then be allowed to build their own nation. It's not our job to build their nation for them. It's their job. But we should stand by them. We should provide them support, as Mr. Trump made clear, and not walk away. I thought he gave a lot of substance in the speech. It was very clearly laid out. It was the antithesis of what we've been seeing and hearing from President Obama and from Hillary Clinton on the stump.
Let me go to someone. Thank you, Buck.
Yeah, real quick. You know, this guy is in the tank for Trump, and he told us that right up front. That speech had so many goddamn holes in it, it reminded me of a sieve. So, anyway, I'm going to shut this down here. You know, that's more than enough. All right, I decided to add this because what this guy said has quite a bit of relevance.
Into all of these countries here that we're referencing, that these nominees are referencing. Ben Wiedemann is our senior international correspondent. He's there in Istanbul, the site of a recent terror attack there at the Ataturk airport. And so, Ben, my question to you is more of a reality check question. We heard Mr. Trump outlining sort of the state of play in 2009. Libya, he said, stable. Syria, under control. Iraq, a reduction in violence. What was it like pre-2011?
Well, I can tell you, If you look, for instance, at the case of Libya, Muammar Gaddafi was in power since 1969. The man was mentally unstable. I interviewed him a variety of times, and it was clear he did not have a sound mind. And what you saw in 2011 was basically, it's like a pressure cooker blowing up after so many years. And of course there's going to be a messy aftermath. Syria, I lived in Syria under Hafez al-Assad, the father of Bashar al-Assad. The Assad family has run Syria since 1971. There were pressures, there were tensions, there was hatred there that was building for decades. And of course we saw that turn into the mess that is Syria today. So to pin this on the Obama administration is, as the general said just a moment ago, somewhat simplistic. And of course, listening to Mr. Trump's speech, in the beginning he went through a list of the attacks in the United States, the attacks in Europe by ISIS. But left out of the equation was, of course, the attacks in places like Iraq, in Syria, by ISIS on Muslims. I was in Baghdad in July, in the aftermath of the July 3rd bombing, which killed more than 300 people, the majority of whom were Muslims, Shia, Sunni, as well as Christians. And I think when people hear this sort of speech in this part of the world, they will react saying, well, we're the ones who are actually paying the highest price when it comes to the war against ISIS. There are Iraqis and Syrians and Libyans and Egyptians who are dying every day in the war against ISIS. And to sort of leave them out of the equation when looking at the price people have paid with ISIS is somewhat galling, I think, for many people around here who feel that they, Muslims, are paying the highest price. Here in Turkey, as you mentioned, the attack on the Atatürk International Airport. This is a 99% Muslim country, and most of the victims of that attack were Muslim. So I think this sort of simplistic interpretation of the war against ISIS is going to cause, to say the least, some annoyance in this part of the world.
Ben Wiedemann, thank you for that.
All right, I thought that was pretty much on point.